beautiful day. I'll pan around just a little bit when we get out of the snow. We find holes in the rock. This is exactly how it happens.
Probably an hour or two, actually.
Obviously, this is the channel run. There he goes. Thank you. See, how could this be a bad day? It's pretty cool. Hello, I'm Mike Blackwell, host of Mike's Wild World. Join me for another edition today as we float down the Saluda River. Joining me today is my friend and outdoorsman, Michael Lavey. Stay tuned, this will be a good trip. Our trip starts near the town of Ware Shoals, South Carolina, and takes us southeast under Highway 25 for over 8 miles to Lake Greenwood.
That'd be a good fishing spot.
It would be a good fishing spot. Okay, we are just down the river a ways, and off to my right is a chain link fence. And inside this fencing area is one of the sanitation areas and dumps the wastewater back into the Saluda River. The water's nice and clear for this time of year and for after the rains that we've had. And appears to be plenty of fish in here, several gar, and it's the middle of the day, so you're not gonna see too much activity right now. Everything's kind of hiding. Up for us, we're out in the canoe.
That's what we're hearing right there. Exactly. Let's try to shoot them. Let's try to stay straight, whatever we do. Let's try to. Go back here, man.
Back to the left?
We're not going to go over that, are we?
You're going to stay left.
Right through there.
Right through here?
I think so. And swing her around. Good.
Here's something you don't see every day. I clean the lens off. In geologic sense, we always see holes in rocks and we don't ever know why. Hold on.
Wait a minute, I gotta get back over there, Mick.
But in the course of geologic time, we find holes in the rock. This is exactly how it happens. We have this current that's just feeding straight in and then back out. It's just swirling. And the rocks and the grit and everything that goes in there just grinds away at it. It's got to take a long time though. You know, hundreds of thousands. This is a really deep hole. Let's get an idea for just how deep it might be. that's a good 4 feet and then out. You think it's coming out the bottom? I mean, I didn't find a bottom in there. So there's a good chance it's actually flowing out from under the rock. I heard this is how Lewis and Clark made such a good time. Or it may have been more like this.
Yes, sir? Do you think those are high water marks there? Or is it?
Yes.
They
That's
are?
High water mark.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. High water mark is the brown spot on the bridge.
Yeah.
Yeah. Caught a fish. Small fish. And what's unusual about the small fish is the way he's hooked. He's hooked right between the eyes, basically. After picking a campsite and unloading our gear, we had a good supper, set up the tent, and looked forward to a good night's rest. Give us a good morning to the camera here.
Good morning. I haven't brushed my teeth yet.
So elaborate.
Wanted to show you this morning, first thing we got going was some fresh water. We're just going to uncap that. What we're doing is we're boiling some river water. I'm just going to turn the flame off on that. And we're going to let this cool down. This is going to take probably an hour or two actually to cool down because it's boiling. This is water that's straight out of the river. And Mick, if you want to, just pan around and grab a shot of the wonderful crystal clear water that's flowing through the stream here. Yeah, that. So that's what you do. Right now we've consumed probably about 2 gallons of water between the two of us since yesterday. And we're going to be out and about in the canoe, and it's going to be another hot day, and it's not nearly enough water. It's something you can't stress. I can't stress it enough that you got to stay hydrated out here, particularly in the heat. The temperature yesterday was right around 100, and we paddled right through the middle of it. One of the things you probably will appreciate, Mick, if you want to show our resident neighbor here, the cow pie, which is right next to our area here. Growing some fresh mushrooms, and I know those are fresh because they wasn't there yesterday. So we know those are awfully fresh. We're going to have a little bit of breakfast this morning, try to do a little bit of fishing, and then we'll head out down the river and show you some sights and sounds from the Saluda River and the upstate of South Carolina.
I wanted to show you something about some of the things that people do with camping and some of the ideas they have. And one of them for our outdoorsmen is always their knife or their favorite knife that they like to use. Now, for me, some of the best times actually was with this small Swiss Army knife like this. And you know, it's just basic, it's fairly sharp, it does a few good things, some scissors on there, tweezers, toothpick, that kind of thing. And that's a standby because you can keep this with you at all times and it goes right in your pocket. That's what a lot of people like to use. And then some people will do something more like this, they'll strap on a knife to, you know, to this side. This side. And this is one that I've used many years, and it's an older style Bowie knife type thing in a little miniature format. And that takes a nice edge, nothing expensive about it, leather handle, and that's a really good all-purpose knife for hunting or fishing. If you're not really good with your knife, don't keep it too sharp. That will do damage. And then you can step up to, this is another one that's been a favorite of mine. It's stainless steel, it has the, you know, the handle, the top comes off of it, and there's supplies inside and the bubble compass that goes on top of it. Now, this knife has made many a trip, has done a really good job. Never had to use the bottle opener, that's for some other purpose I suppose. And comes with a sharpening stone in the case, like this. That's a nice feature to have. Oops, that goes this way. And then you can step up to other items, which in many cases is absolutely necessary. This is Mick. Remember Mick? See this? Now that's stainless steel, aluminum handle, and it also has the compartment, has the compass inside. And then a set of supplies like matches and a striker plate. Actually, that's an interesting concept between matches and a striker plate. If you have safety matches, which most homes would have that now, not strike anywhere, the side of the box is necessary to strike the match. So when you use safety matches in a situation like this, you have to bring the side of the box with you, or a striker plate, to actually strike the matches. They won't strike on a rock or anything like that. Part of the chemical compound is actually in the side of the box, which makes it light. That's important. And then there's other things that you would need. It's something like this, and this is also something that Mick has brought with him. It is something similar to a bush axe or a machete. What do you call this?
A woodman's pal.
Woodman's pal, that's the word Mick knows. And it's been really critical here for us to be able to get up the bank, since there was overgrowth and everything here. Most of the banks on a riverside, generally of a flowing river like this, are going to be much higher, and you may have to fight your way up, you know, the bank to find a place to camp. And that's been the case with what we did. Sometimes you can find a nice easy place, and sometimes not. It's critical not to overtax yourself when you're trying to pick a campsite, but you also need to pick a place that's safe, to be concerned about rising waters, things like that. So camping on a sandbar, not a good idea. Find the higher ground. Rivers are notorious for after rains that don't have to be here. The rain could be miles and miles upstream, and by morning it's flooding your area and you never see a drop of rain. So be mindful of that kind of thing. All sorts of knives to pick from. Pick something that suits you. You don't have to be a Rambo to be an outdoorsman or to enjoy the great outdoors, but a knife is probably one of your best friends when you're out in the great outdoors.
Oh, there's nothing quite like that peace and quiet.
That's a sweet one, Mike.
Yeah.
All right. So I'll untie.
Yep, you'll untie. And I'll hang on to the rope while you untie it. And hand this down to me. Go ahead. And I'm going to cut it. This, to dock it or to put stuff in it, works just fine unless there's things in the water that can poke a hole in the canoe. Remember, it's empty now, so if there's a rock, which is what I found underneath it, took the rock out, then brought the canoe on up. If I load that full of a couple hundred pounds of supplies with a rock under it, it could poke a hole right through it. Don't want to do that. Thank you. it is warming up tremendously. I'm going to show you the canoe since we've got this kind of loaded up now. And yeah, we're in here up under a shade tree. There's Mick, outdoorsman extraordinaire. What we're trying to do is to balance the canoe up. But there's one important factor is we have some stuff here that we really don't want to get wet. More than not get it wet, we don't want to lose it. And so as you can see, it's actually strapped to the canoe. I doubt we'll actually lose the canoe at any particular time should we even capsize. It has flotation places built into it. The seats on this model is actually the flotation. Those are airtight chambers and it will keep the canoe afloat. Can't keep the flanua coat, but the canoe will stay on top of the water for the most part and you'll be able to turn it back over. Everything is recoverable and everything is in waterproof wrapping or in bags that needs to stay absolutely dry. So we're going to launch this out. We have several miles of river to traverse here this morning, and we'll show you the rest of the scenery. Stick around for the rest of the show.
Hat like this would be really important when you're down on the river. You see, because you can wear it either way, like that or like that. I would say we're off, but you probably already figured that out by now. You can tell as we move down the river, as Mick does a wonderful job of paddling, we move in and out of the shady spots, and this is just such a pleasant place to be. We can get away from the stress of the world. You know, sometimes the fast pace of cell phones and destinations, they become a little much. If that's the case, then this is what you need to do. Find an outlet for that. Get out on the rivers. This is a scenic place right in our own backyard. And all it takes is a canoe or a boat, some basic safety skills, and you're not going to have any problems out here. This is just a gorgeous day, and we've had a great camp out. Mick's a great outdoorsman, so he keeps me straight on a lot of things, and he keeps us safe. It's important to go and have fun, but it's also important to return from all that fun. You don't want to spoil something by having an accident. Let's take a look at the river.
Dad, burn it. The fly bit me. He's a dead fly now. He had vice grips. I mean, he's, you know, small package, but dad burned.
Fiber.
Yeah, he needs stitches. Darn.
I want to take a moment to show you a few paddle strokes that you might need while you're out canoeing. We pulled up into the shade and made a few changes here. So we're just going to back out. And of course, when you're in shallow water, use your paddle as a pole, basically, to pole yourself back. And you see we're just barely floating. So we'll head right out to the deep water. And what I'm going to do is, obviously, we're just going to turn the canoe around and we'll get it stopped. If I want to go that way, I'm going to paddle over here. But if the paddle can go way out, and when you do, it forces you around. We're not really going anywhere except in a circle, basically, because I took such a long stroke with the paddle. And then if I want to go forward, I go downward. But even going down like this, canoe will still veer to the other side. Anytime you're like this, you're going to go that way. But there is a stroke you can use to help that. And that would be if I want to go straight, which now you can see I'm veering back that way. If I go out and I do a kick flip, I can actually turn the canoe. Now watch, you'll see me turn just by doing that. Back in, and then at the end of that stroke, I'm going to flip my paddle. I can paddle on one side of the canoe continuously without flipping. Generally, if you're paddling by yourself, you're going to do a stroke and change. Stroke, change. Well, it's really good for your exercise, but it'll really wear you out fast. Plus, you sling water all over the place. Watch this. If I come back around, you see the water droplets? It won't be long. You'll fill your canoe up with water. I promise you. It'll be all over your feet. But now, as you can see, I'm veering to the left. You can probably see that from behind me by the trail that we're leaving. I'm going to straighten that out right now just by using my paddle as a rudder. And that'll bring me around. I'm not even going to paddle on the other side. And I can actually turn the course of the canoe all the way around like this, all in one stroke. If I want to go backwards now, I can parallel park, whatever it takes, back. Just like changing gears. And turned all the way around. I like paddling backwards because it gives me a lot of control in this end of the canoe. I'm close to the water, that's by design. The front seat is positioned so that you're kind of at a wider spot of the canoe and you don't get that deep thrust into the water. You kind of have to reach out a little bit. But back here in the back, you can make this thing do just about whatever you want it to do. Don't be afraid to use the canoe as a prop. You can actually do a push to go sideways. In some cases, you'll be doing a pull. Like in this case, I'm just going to give me a push out, just like that. In a current where it's running pretty fast, you're going to be doing a lot of this because it's going to be taking you where it wants you to go instead of you going where you want to go. And right now, we're just going to head downstream and see what else this river has to offer. See you in a minute. Nick is paddling and I'm going to take a little water break. And this is a 2-quart canteen. I'd think for a minute, did I say quart or quart? But anyway, a 2-quart canteen. Now this water just a few hours ago was in the river. And you can see how green this is. It has a brown tint to it. There's cow pastures on either side, so the cows come down and drink and use the river as a bathroom quite often. And this is the same water. However, it has been boiled. And as you know, boiling water purifies it. It actually changed the color of the water too. It probably had some green tint to it. The boiling killed all the algae in it. It was very clear by the time we poured it up. And without this, we'd have a really long day ahead of us without enough water. So don't be afraid of the water if you boil it. There are other sanitation ways of doing it, but boiling is absolutely the best way to go.
You need to be careful here now. You know, run over a rock.
It'll bounce, yeah.
Oh no, Mick.
Here, let's go this way.
That was a pull stroke because of the branches. Thank you. We're parked up under a tree in the shade for just a moment.
Mick, why do you like the outdoors?
Well, it's a challenge. It's exercising. I love finding the fishing spots. I love the challenge of catching a fish. I like the temperatures. I don't like being in air conditioning. The natural cool at night and the slow warm-up during the day is even better.
Little brim swimming up.
There's my ride. So it's time to pack. As you saw, my ride's here. We gotta go. See you guys. Watch the speed. We're gonna match your stroke, Mick. We're getting it. Dang, I heard banjo music. Thank the fine support team who come out to pick us up today. And I thank my friend Mick Lavey for being here to help keep things straight. And for this edition of Mick's Wild World, this is Mick Blackwell. We'll see you next time. Welcome to another edition. No, that's not it.
Bye, Blaze.
You want me to say Mick? Or you want me to say Mick?
Yeah, because you're Mick, I'll be the Mick.
Can't keep the Flanua coat.
Hat like this be really important when you're down on the river.
We gotta go. See you guys.
I need a new reel.